This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Meatsplaining, the animal agriculture industry, and the rhetoric of denial. Edited by Jason Hannan. Published by Sydney University Press. For the Winnipeg vegan community. Acknowledgements by Jason Hannan. This book is the product of a certain frustration, that of confronting the systematic, well-funded, and relentless propaganda of the animal agriculture industry, arguably one of the most powerful forms of modern industrial capitalism on the planet today. Although frustration can sometimes give way to a sense of futility, it can also lead to critique and resistance. One crucial step toward the latter end is to name the devil. That's what this book sets out to do. And so the idea of meatsplaining was born. My interest in the rhetoric of the animal agriculture industry arose through my teaching and civic engagement. At the University of Winnipeg, I have been very fortunate to be able to teach a fun and rewarding course called The Rhetoric of Animality. I am grateful to my department chair and dear friend, Jacqueline McLeod Rogers, for encouraging me to create this course in the first place and for giving me all the departmental support I could possibly ask for. Since introducing the course in 2015, I have had the pleasure of teaching some very bright students who care deeply about animals and the planet. These students have come from a wide range of disciplines, creating a lively atmosphere for vigorous discussion and debate. This also means that I receive some highly original research papers, which have played a large part in my education about animal exploitation. I am grateful to my students for teaching me as much as I have taught them. One of my main preoccupations over the last several years has been to work with an incredible committee to organize Winnipeg VegFest, an annual festival that attracts some 4,000 visitors each year. The primary aim of Winnipeg VegFest is to raise awareness about animals and the planet, and to cultivate an ethic and lifestyle of compassion. Each year we host a remarkable lineup of speakers who include academics, activists, artists, physicians, and scientists. Among them, I am especially grateful to Carol Adams, Milton Mills, Caldwell Esselstyn, Gary Francione, Anita Crines, Margaret Robinson, Camille Labchik, Dave Nickers, and Anna Pippas, from whom I have learned so much about the animal agriculture industry. It also bears mentioning that this volume was designed explicitly with the Winnipeg VegFest community and similar communities across the globe in mind. It further bears mentioning that VegFest would not have been possible without the immense generosity of the University of Winnipeg and the Winnipeg Humane Society. Annette Trimby, Chris Meineker, and Javier Schwersensky deserve special recognition and gratitude for their financial and institutional support for VegFest since its inception. I wish to thank my colleagues at the University of Winnipeg and the University of Manitoba for their support for VegFest over the last few years. Fiona Green, Matthew Flissfetter, Robin Flissfetter, Kimberly Ducey, Nannies Ibrahim, Peter Ives, Paul Laurie, Rosaria Moretti Laurie, Ray Silvius, Jill Bucklechuk, Arthur Walker Jones, Sharanpal Rupri, Dana Maduro, Serenity Jew, Jane Barter, Andrew McGillivray, Angela McGillivray, Delia Gavrus, Christina Fawcett, Alan Joseph McGreevy, and David Navratil. I owe sincere thanks to Melissa Boyd and Fiona Proben Rapsi for taking the initial interest in this volume and for including it in their wonderful Animal Public series at Sydney University Press. I also cannot speak highly enough of SUP's incredible staff. Sincere thanks are owed to Agata Merva Montoya, Denise O'Dea, Nathan Grice, Joanna Butler, Marie-Louise Taylor, and Susan Murray. They deserve high praises for their incredible professionalism and hard work, especially under the challenging conditions of the COVID-19 pandemic. It has been a sincere pleasure working with them. Some of the material in this volume has been published previously. I would like to acknowledge the publishers for their permission to reprint that material here. A portion of the introduction previously appeared in Hannan, J. 2019, A Blind Spot in Political Theory, Justice, Deliberation, and Animals. Journal of Animal Ethics 9-1, 27-38. Chapter 9 previously appeared in Robinson, M. 2013, Veganism and Micmac Legends. The Canadian Journal of Native Studies 33-1, 189-196. Lastly, I wish to thank the contributors to this volume, both for writing excellent chapters and for their patience as we navigated our way through the long and winding road to publication. Their contributions not just met, but far exceeded my expectations. I can only hope that they are as pleased with the final outcome as I am. Foreword by David Nybert, Professor of Sociology, Wittenberg University. Considerable social engineering has occurred in the last 100 years to promote and increase the consumption of the flesh, eggs, and milk of other animals, especially among the relatively more affluent throughout the world. In the United States, the deadly theft of land from indigenous peoples and free-living non-human animals made possible the profitable expansion of ranching. These economic gains were made even greater by the oppression of slaughterhouse workers, disproportionately people of color and immigrants, who were economically coerced into killing ever-growing numbers of cows, pigs, chickens, and similarly oppressed other animals. Such monstrous oppression was possible due to oppressors' control of the state apparatus, and it was rationalized and normalized through the use of speciesism, racism, sexism, classism, and related ideologies spun and disseminated by capitalist elites. Early in the 20th century, powerful business entities seized control of nascent mass media technology, including those companies within the animal industrial complex who sought to convince the public that consumption of slaughterhouse fare was safe, healthy, and essential. For instance, in the 1920s, Edward L. Bernays, considered by some to be the founder of U.S. public relations, created a campaign to promote a bacon and egg breakfast, a morning meal he deviously implied was supported by physicians. Some very popular early 20th century radio programs in the United States were sponsored by slaughterhouse firms, which included one starring comedians George Burns and Gracie Allen, who plugged the George A. Hormel and Company product Spam, derived from oppressed pigs. One of the first fast food companies, White Castle, campaigned at length to increase consumption of their hamburgers by targeting college students, mothers, and children with claims that their product was safe and highly nutritious. In advertisements during World War II, the United States government perpetuated the long-standing idea that the consumption of meat was very important for men, especially, quote, fighting men, end quote. Other powerful countries also violently expropriated lands for ranching and utilized similar strategies to increase the consumption of slaughterhouse products. In the 1950s, for example, slaughterhouse firms in Canada sought to promote outdoor barbecuing by suggesting, quote, a direct relationship between meat, barbecuing, and virile heterosexual masculinity, end quote. Chris Dummett writes, quote, Canadian packers sought to strengthen the association between meat and barbecuing. In the summer of 1955, the company offered a free portable brazier to consumers who purchased a specific amount of their canned meat products, including beef stew, bologna, beans with wieners, and click pork luncheon meat. In the image accompanying the offer, a smiling apron-clad man serves a Fred Flintstone-sized steak to an appreciative female onlooker, suggesting that Canadian packers could continue its service to the virile, meat-hungry new barbecue owner. Chris Dummett, 1998, Finding a Place for Father, Selling the Barbecue in Postwar Canada, Journal of the Canadian Historical Association, Volume 9, Number 1, 216, end quote. For decades, such advertising campaigns and related narratives thoroughly blanketed the cultures of many Western societies. One facet of this indoctrination has been the contention that human animals are natural flesh eaters and that meat consumption is essential for human health. Indeed, for decades, the academic establishment not only largely genuflected to the animal industrial complex, but also promoted the idea that the practice of stalking, killing, and eating other animals made possible both human social and brain development. As numerous scholars have observed, much of the established scholarship and theory of the past largely was a reflection of the hegemonic culture and conventions of the times. Today, when growing numbers of people have instant access to information, it takes considerable ideological maneuvering to maintain the nefarious belief that most non-human inhabitants of the planet are merely food, and that their oppression is both natural and necessary. The rapidly growing body of critical work by new generations of scholars is producing a rising public awareness of the awful oppression of other animals and its connection to a myriad of critical global problems, which includes the climate emergency and the growing threat of a deadly global pandemic. and today scholars increasingly are talking about the entangled oppression of humans and other animals, oppression that is entangled economically, politically, and ideologically. In response to this growing...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.